Bob Costas is joining us. Football Night in America, Baseball Network, got the playoffs coming up. And a man who probably has told maybe daily basis, maybe an hourly basis, hey, stick to sports, Bob. It's really hard to stick to sports. How do you answer it now?
I always thought it was kind of a dumb comment. And the real translation of it was, stick to sports as long as you're saying something that I disagree with, stick to sports, or that I don't want to hear. But if we agree with it, great. You know, Fox News had Bob Knight on, and I've had a good relationship with Bob Knight. Who knows why? But I'm among the people who've had a good relationship with Bob Knight forever. I've had dinner with him many times. He's invited me when he coached Indiana to come to Indiana and be at practices and be at games and whatnot. And he sat for interviews with me. So I have no problem with Bob Knight personally. But Bob Knight was an avid and is an avid Trump supporter. Fox News puts Bob Knight on as if he's a political pundit. That's not stick to sports, because you're saying what we want to hear.
Well,
but
Lou
stick
Holtz.
To sports when you don't.
They had Lou Holtz on.
Sure. Sure. Hey, look, if you can't get Bill Moyers, get Lou Holtz.
But how, I'm trying to think how, if we've ever had anything that is remotely close to this past week, and I went back to, you know, when Kennedy was assassinated, that the NFL didn't postpone games. But you have this past weekend, and I said as soon as I saw it, and then Monday morning, ESPN will make that a 30 for 30 one day.
Sure they will.
Where you just go around and kind of canvass the room 10 years after, 5 years after, with whatever, and I don't know if it changes anything. But it may, we may look back on that 5 or 10 years from now and say activism in sports and what it was a springboard there.
Sure. You know, we did a thing on NBCSN on the 50th anniversary of the Kennedy assassination about how it affected the Dallas Cowboys, who were playing in Cleveland on that Sunday, and they didn't cancel the games. It was a different window in. Was it the most important window? No. But it was a very interesting story.
Yeah.
You know, Roger Staubach was then playing at Navy, won the Heisman Trophy, later the Cowboy quarterback, of course, was on the cover of Time magazine. But they canceled the cover, and of course Kennedy went on the cover instead of Roger Staubach. There are stories when sports just intersects with the real world. A very good 30 for 30 that I think Jim Gray produced for ESPN was about George Bush's first pitch at the World Series in 2001. It was only a half hour 30 for 30, but regardless of your politics, George Bush lifted the nation that night. So post 9/11, what's happening now, Tommy Smith and John Carlos, Muhammad Ali. It's not just that sports sometimes intersects with social issues, but sometimes it is the place. Wasn't it the place with Jackie Robinson? Wasn't it the place with Muhammad Ali? Didn't Billie Jean King have something to do with the women's liberation movement? I think she did.
Yeah. If I said you could interview President Trump or Colin Kaepernick?
I actually think Colin Kaepernick would be the more interesting interview, because President Trump expresses himself on a daily basis multiple times, whereas Colin Kaepernick, whose right to protest I respect and whose intentions I think are genuine because he's walked the walk, he's donated and or raised millions of dollars, and he's involved in community projects. But he's disappeared. He's off the radar. Except for tweets, he doesn't say anything. And some of the things he has said, I think, actually undermine the legitimate issue that he's been trying to call attention to. When you say, I don't vote because the oppressor will never allow you to vote your way out of oppression, well, then I guess it doesn't matter to him that a number of African Americans and some white people died trying to secure his predecessors the right to vote. It doesn't matter to him that Barack Obama was president when he first knelt and Donald Trump now is president. When you wear socks to practice that depict cops, not rogue cops, but all cops, because that's what you're wearing, as pigs, when you praise Fidel Castro, maybe it's better that Colin Kaepernick either explain himself or never be heard from again. He started the movement. He started the effort, a legitimate one, to call attention to a very real issue. But now, when you hear someone like Doug Baldwin, who was on with Anderson Cooper the other night on a town hall, when you hear how thoughtful and well-informed and nuanced his viewpoint is, I want to hear from more people like Doug Baldwin.
How concerned would you be if you're the NFL with fan reaction to this? Because people aren't really, they're not going back to Colin Kaepernick's initial missive here. That they're sort of, they're reading into, you take a knee, you're anti-American. You picked your side if you take a knee, and I'm not on that side.
Yeah.
How concerned should the NFL be with this?
I think they have to be somewhat concerned because what Donald Trump has done, and he has an almost unique talent for this, he knows how to push hot buttons for his base. And he's turned this into something that it does not have to be. And he's forced players and even owners to choose. Many of these owners are very conservative politically, but Trump's undifferentiated comments and calling everybody SOBs, many of whom are very decent and concerned people who do good deeds on a constant basis, they have to side with their employees. And teammates, black or white, are going to side with the people that they stand shoulder to shoulder with on the field or in the clubhouse. So Trump has changed that narrative, and the owners can't back away. The commissioner can't back away from the majority of the players in the league. But at the same time, you've got a false narrative out there, but it resonates with a lot of people, which is, hey, if you take a knee, you're not patriotic. You're disrespecting the military. You're disrespecting the flag, even though patriotism has more aspects to it than that. So I would offer a humble suggestion, and it's only a suggestion. Who am I, a fortunate white man, to have lived the life that I've led? Who am I to tell any African-American what he should do? But this is a suggestion. It's gotten to the point where the issue is well understood. There, even though now it's been muddied by Trump, the initial issue is understood by anyone who wants to understand it. So in that sense, good for Colin Kaepernick. But now you have to say, what's the most effective way to go about this? Not just to make a statement or express concern or even anger. What's the most effective way to persuade the persuadable? And so my suggestion would be, stand for the national anthem. But the moment it's over, take a knee. On the last note, take a knee. We know that the networks, at least for the time being, are going to cover the national anthem. You and I both know that most of the time, baseball game, football game, they try to be in commercial. Unless it's a special occasion like the Super Bowl or the World Series with a noted singer, they try to be in commercial. Now they're going to show because people want to see what the players will do. Think of how they could positively change the narrative if they stood for the anthem, which indicates what most of them say, which is that they respect the flag, they love their country, et cetera, et cetera. And the instant it's over, take a knee. Now what are you going to say, Mr. Love It or Leave It? I think that'd be a good move, but that's just my suggestion.
We'll take a break on that. We'll come back with Bob Costas. We'll talk some baseball. He's got postseason duties. We'll talk about all these home runs, Giancarlo Stanton's season, Aaron Judge's season, and who he thinks has the best chance to play in the World Series. Bob Costas staying with us. Baseball Network and NBC Football Night in America. No Olympics.
Done with the Olympics. Mike Tirico can take the baton.
When's the last Olympics that you didn't do?
Well, there were some Olympics in the early 90s, Lillehammer and Albertville, CBS. Which were on CBS. Yep. The first Winter Olympics that we had at NBC was in, at least in the modern era, was in 2002 in Salt Lake City. But the last Summer Olympics that I didn't do was 1984 in Los Angeles. Every Summer Olympics since 88 in Seoul I did.
What do you think of the possibility of having... Could we do a rotation with cities, winter and summer? Mm-hmm. I know that the IOC loves to have bidders and the whole process here, but we got to make financial sense, fiscal sanity here. Could you do that where you had Los Angeles 1 year and then, London 1 year, maybe three rotating? Is that possible?
Maybe you have a summer and a winter location on each continent that's able to put an Olympics on. And maybe the IOC and some coalition of wealthier nations kind of make it possible to occasionally have it in Athens because of the historic significance. But you can't move it around all the time. And one of the reasons, whether they acknowledge it or not, that the IOC cozies up to authoritarian regimes, a Summer Olympics, which is one thing, but then a Winter Olympics in Beijing, a Winter Olympics in Sochi, where we knew even before The dastardly fellows gave me pink eye. We knew that there was something wrong. There was something wrong with the whole idea of
Are you accusing Putin of giving you... Did they hack your eye, Bob?
It's entirely possible. Okay. Entirely possible. Okay. I would not rule it out. I'm waiting for Robert Mueller's report.
I like that.
It could be in there, in the fine print. But everybody knew, even before the full revelations of the doping, we knew that was their deal,
yeah.
Okay, in a general sense. We knew that the whole nation was corrupt. We knew that they had anti-gay laws. We knew that journalists disappeared or worse. We knew that they had expansionist intentions in Ukraine and in Crimea. We knew, all right? But one of the reasons the IOC goes to these locations is because authoritarian nations do not complain afterwards, geez, you left us with this gigantic debt. Security is always better because they're authoritarian nations, and they don't have to count on donations and whatnot. Volunteers will work for 6 months every single day in Beijing to put on the most amazing opening ceremony ever. So back to your question, there are fewer and fewer places. We loved our experience in Rio. We had a great time.
Yeah, they're
and
good
they,
people.
They pulled it off, and they are wonderful people, warm-hearted, welcoming. But if you live in a favela in Rio, what good did those Olympics do you?
Nothing.
And you're left with these sites that no one uses anymore and more debt. So there are fewer and fewer places that actually can pull this off and have it make sense. LA may be one of them because they've got a lot of the facilities already in place. But we saw that there was very little enthusiasm in Chicago a couple of cycles ago. There was no enthusiasm at all in Boston.
Yeah.
The mayor of Rome says, forget about it. We don't want it. So to your point, they may have to get to where, look, we've got a handful of sites. We just take care of the upkeep and the maintenance, and we go from there.
We have a bet. Paulie has a bet here. He thinks that Michael Phelps will compete again. Now, Paulie bet Phelps.
I guarantee he's going to compete in the next Olympics. But we have a side bet if you would like a piece of it.
Yes.
More likely to happen, Michael Phelps competes in the next Summer Olympics, Bob Costas on the property working at the next Summer Olympics.
A is more likely than B. Because I have made my decision. And unlike my friend Michael Phelps, when I made the decision, it is final.
Do you think Phelps will compete 2020?
If he did, I think it would be one or two events.
Yes.
At most. But from what I saw of him at the trials in Omaha and speaking with him in Rio, he really is at peace. And I think that if I had to bet, I bet no. But is there a possibility?
Yeah.
Sure there is.
Maybe he wants his son to see him swim.
You know, that's something. That's something. Little Boomer.
Yeah.
And we don't mean Boomer Esiason.
No, we do not.
Or Boomer Berman.
No, we do not.
We mean Boomer Phelps.
The baseball playoffs coming up. Of course, MLB Network will have games, playoff games here coming up. Handicap the postseason here.
Cleveland's the best team, not just because they're incredibly hot going in, but because you look at their pitching now. Corey Kluber has overtaken Chris Sale for Cy Young, and we had basically awarded it to Sale at midseason. Trevor Bauer is pitching lights out. The two guys they didn't have among their starting rotation in October, they do have now. Andrew Miller is back. Their bullpen is deep. Their lineup is so good that Francisco Lindor, who would be a solid MVP candidate considering the position he plays and the power he provides and his presence on the field and in the clubhouse, in most years he'd be an MVP candidate. He doesn't even appear to be in the discussion. And they have one of the best managers in baseball. So Cleveland's the best team. But that first round for any good team is the most treacherous. No disrespect intended to the Twins, but they are not quite, anyone can win a given game. Irvin Santana could shut the Yankees down next Tuesday and the Twins could move on.
Yeah.
But if it's the Yankees, you could see the Yankees winning a best of five from Cleveland.
Yeah.
It could happen.
How do we look at current power numbers? How do you think history is going to look at this season?
No one can say flatly that PED use is gone. But you can say this. If guys are cheating, and it makes sense that at least some are willing to take the risk for the possible reward, they're not able to do the full-blown turn yourself into a cyborg thing that guys could do in the 90s and at the turn of the century before there was not only testing and punishment, but as we saw with A-Rod and the biogenesis thing, I've got that right. It was Biogenesis, yeah. Right? They're willing to use what they call non-analytic evidence, a paper trail or whatever it may be. So they're more and more vigilant about it. So if guys are cheating now, I think they're getting a smaller edge and a smaller boost from it than they used to. Then there are other factors. So many guys throw 95 or above now that hitters have adjusted to it. And when a pitch comes in at that velocity, it's providing some of the power itself. We've known that since we were kids. Guys would marvel if someone hit a changeup 400 feet. Well, he provided all the power himself. Yeah. Now it's mere physics. You've got guys this big and this strong, most of them legitimately from weight training and whatnot. And the pitch is coming in at that speed and they catch up with it. The other factor, I've had many pitchers and former pitchers tell me that the baseball has seams that are slightly lower. I'm not saying this is a conspiracy. It's just whatever this run of baseballs was, it's produced balls where the seams are lower. And that means that there's less break on a breaking ball, and more importantly, a little bit less drag once the ball is in the air. And that may contribute to it too.
Who do you consider the single season home run record? Personally, who do you consider?
Statistically, there's no question that Barry Bonds holds that record. But the most authentic one belongs to Roger Maris. Roger Maris has the authentic single season record, and Hank Aaron has the authentic career record.
What do you make of Giancarlo Stanton's season?
We have to assume that it's all on the up and up, and he's just a great player with great power who's come along at a time that's conducive to it. The conditions in the game are conducive to it. Most of the new ballparks are hitter-friendly. The launch angle approach, we don't care if you strike out 200 times. Sabermetrics tells us as long as your OPS is good, we don't care whether you hit a ground ball to second base that moves the guy from second to third. At least in most situations, we don't care. The baseball, the velocity, all those things, a confluence of circumstances, and then you get a guy like Aaron Judge or Giancarlo Stanton, so big, so strong, they've arrived at the right time. You know, Carl Yastrzemski won the batting title in the American League in 1968, the year of the pitcher, hitting 301. I'm pretty sure that if Carl Yastrzemski were in his prime today, he'd hit 330, at least, you know, in his best year. So everything's a product of circumstance to some extent. As great as Wilt Chamberlain was, would he be great today? Of course he would. Could he average 50 points a game? He'd have 50-point games, but could he average 50 points a game? No.
You know what I miss in baseball is just the action.
Oh, my gosh, yes.
And you're doing play-by-play, but there is no action, Bob.
Yeah.
And it probably makes it even tougher for you as a play-by-play guy that it's all fill. It's not, I'm going to ground ball to second. And I hated sabermetrics when they, if you didn't move the runner over, you know, by hitting it to the second baseman, that somehow that's not value. But it is, because there's a chance he misses the ball. You get the guy over to third and sack fly, like small things. But I do miss just regular action that we took for granted in baseball.
Well, there are so many so-called true outcomes. More homers, more walks, more strikeouts. And even if the guy doesn't strike out or walk, if you're getting more strikeouts and walks, that also means you're getting more deep counts. Maybe it's resolved by a ground ball to shortstop, but you've gone to 3-2. You've gone to 2-2. So that's more pitches. Plus, guys seem to be taking an eternity between pitches, which is why Rob Manfred is pushing for a pitch clock, at least with nobody on base. And then you have all the pitching changes on top of it. So it isn't so much even length of game, which is bad enough sometimes. It's pace of game and absence of action. But you know what's one thing I haven't had a chance to say on the air? An unintended byproduct of the rule about blocking home plate, which is designed to protect both the catcher and the runner from injury, is that you get more picturesque, exciting plays at the plate.
Yeah.
You really do, because the catcher has to position himself in such a way, he comes back, and you see guys with hook slides that, you know, that would make Ty Cobb proud.
Yeah, creativity.
Yeah. That's actually created more excitement, and that's the kind of action you want to see more of.
He's Bob Costas, Major League Baseball Network, play-by-play coming up. Got a couple of games in the wild card round, and it's great to have you stop by, Bob.
Thank you, Dan.
We appreciate that.
The Dan Patrick Show, weekday mornings on Audience.